Bible we tell to the children of Israel, that Lord, we may learn the lessons thereof and avoid their mistakes and emulate that which they did right. I pray that you forgive me my sins and that you may use me as a vessel for this work. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
So Lord went to Egypt, Lord went to Sodom, he left with what? He left with what? And his is not an isolated example. We normally don't get much from the city. We don't get much from the system of education that it was, because you will always find that you cannot use it in God's work. You cannot use the methods and the sentiments that are often interwoven with the education that you get. You can't use them for the service of God. And those that have tried to use them for God's service have failed. So as well we are to go and have a new experience, God has to take us through another training. God has to retrain us like he did Moses in the wilderness for 40 years.
First God's principles of life
dwelt among the fields and the hills. They were what?
Tillers
of the soil and keepers of flocks and herds. And in this free, independent life, with its opportunities for labor and study and meditation, they learned of God and taught their children of His works and His ways. So as you're thinking about the true education, let us think about it using God's plan. It's a family-based education. It's an education in which the people were in the fields and they were tillers of the soil and keepers of flocks and herds. This was the method of education that God desired to establish in Israel. But when brought out of Egypt, there were among the Israelites few prepared to be workers within in the training of their children. Alright? We moved from Eden, we see what God had planned. We looked at the patriarchs and we saw that God's plan of education was based in the family. And this was the same method of education that God desired to establish where? In Israel. Okay? But when brought out of Egypt, there were among the Israelites few prepared to be workers with him in the training of the children. Why? The parents themselves needed instruction and discipline. Victims of lifelong slavery, they were ignorant, untrained, and degraded. They had little knowledge of God and little faith in Him. They were confused by false teaching and corrupted by their long contact with what? Heathenism. Okay? God desired to lift them to a higher moral level, and to this end He sought to give them a knowledge of Himself. And I would like us to replace the word Israel with yourself. Oh, you are looking at me and wondering why. Because this is the same problem we have. We have all been where? In Egypt. There is no true education that has been ever for a long time, more than 100 years. And all of us have gone through an Egyptian system of education, including myself. And so as you are thinking of true education, you need to know that you are ignorant, okay? And you are untrained. And you are degraded. Your secular education tells you that you came from a frog. Aren't you degraded? You think of yourself like it is, they say that it is survival for the fittest. After all, don't they select the best from each level of education to continue their studies? Don't they select the best? So if you didn't pass primary, you cannot go to the best secondary, isn't it? If you didn't pass the secondary school, you may not make it to the best university. You are degraded. And so if you never made it to the university, you are looked down upon by society. You are useless. Aren't you degraded? Yes, you are. And so when I look at that paragraph, it reflects us today, the remnant, the people who are professed present truth believers. We are like the Israelites coming out of Egypt. And so for us to understand what we need to do for true education, we need to study what God has to do with the Israelites, because that's what He wants to do for us. These things were written for our admonition. Why do you read the book of Exodus? Why would God dedicate a whole 3 or 4 books about the life of the Israelites? Why? You think it was just to entertain you? Was God wanting to entertain us with something to read when we are reading His Word? No. Because we go through the same experience. We just that we think we are so smart. You find a pig that has been in the mud and you tell the pig it's dirty, it doesn't understand what you're saying. Because it's all muddy. It's used to being in the mud. And so when we have been in the mud of Egypt, everybody is muddy all around. We're just seeing how muddy are you better than me. And so we need to understand that this experience the Israelites had is the same experience we have today. We have accepted that you are not so good. We have accepted that you are not a child of God. We have accepted that we were not created in the image of God. By the sentiments that the devil has interwoven in the common systems of education, they degrade humanity. And so we are ignorant, untrained, and degraded. They had little knowledge of God and little faith in Him, don't we? We don't even have faith as much as the Israelites. I told you that the Israelites walked towards the ocean. If it was today, somebody is telling you, hey, let's get out of here, we're getting to a better place, and you're walking towards the ocean, you will look at the guy and say, what's wrong with you? Where are we going? But the Israelites at least walked up to the shore of the ocean. We are not told that they grumbled. When they grumbled, it was after they had crossed the ocean and there was no water. But they had faith to walk all the way up to the ocean, the Red Sea. So they had more faith than we do today. We use a lot of logic. Whenever God wants us to do something, we try to reason out. We want scientific proof before we can actually have faith. That is not faith. If I must show you scientifically why you should not, you should have a health reform, then even if you reform, that is not faith. You are going by reason. And so when you look at the story of the Israelites, it is our story today. The people who were in this place, not even the people who were in the regular line. You know the regular line? You know, you guys are in the irregular lines. This is an illegal meeting. Don't you guys know that? This meeting is illegal, according to the church. So you are in the irregular line. Why are you guys looking at me? You didn't know that? Okay, we are so slow. Alright, let's try it. This, I am talking about this. You are professed present truth believers, aren't you?
Yes.
You are in the irregular line. Because the regular lines don't believe in present truth. They don't even want to hear it. So you need to understand that these truths, the truths you've been hearing here this week, cannot be allowed in the regular churches. Absolutely. If a pastor ever forgot and you preach this truth, he will be summoned at the conference. So this is irregular. And I'm saying this is the people that have been given more light. And I'm saying we are ignorant and trained and what? Degraded. So how much more are those in the regular life?
Us.
And so because the Israelites were the chosen of God, they were given the oracles. They are the ones who were given the Ten Commandments written by the finger of God. Okay? And so they had little knowledge of human, little faith. They were confused by false teaching. And we've been confused by false teaching.
Yes.
I was telling you guys that we were, God created the sun on the fourth day. And the sun and the moon and the stars were given for seasons, for days and weeks and months and years, isn't it?
Yes.
They were supposed to serve the inhabitants of the earth. Never was the earth created to serve the sun. No. And it's in the Bible, but you're looking at me like I was giving you something strange. We have been confused by false teaching and corrupted by long contact with heathenism. We have been in contact with heathenism ever since we were children. You know? Singing birthday songs and observing all these Babylonian rites, we have been messed up. You know, the other day I was looking at a presentation which I hope one day that we would get to see how we have a naked church. How many times we've been going to swimming pools, hardly clothed, completely naked, and we see we are swimming, we are looking fine. Contact with the heathen. You can actually walk around without clothes with your other ladies and men, and there is no shame. And because we have been brainwashed since children that it's okay
to be without clothes at the pool and on the beach, but when you are in the classroom or at home, you should not, you should be dressed. What foolishness is that? That people should actually be in the swimming pool, barely clothed, and that's normal? You don't even understand. That is how we know that we have been corrupted with a long contact with what?
Heathenism.
What is the symbol for nakedness in the Bible? Nakedness is what? What is the meaning of nakedness in the Bible? Means sin. It's a symbol of sin. When Adam and Eve sinned, what did they become? They fell out naked. And so the devil has made us to think that it's okay to be naked in the swimming pool, on the beaches. You know, today, if we were in Mombasa and we were in the regular lines, we would say, today we are going to the beach, and all you guys will remove your clothes. And we shall all be sitting there and saying we are enjoying God's creation of the ocean without clothes. And nobody will protest. That is how we have been brainwashed. It is evil to walk around without clothes. That is how the Israelites have been in Egypt. They were so accustomed with heathenism. God's desire to lift them to a higher moral level, and to this end, he sought to give them a knowledge of himself. So when you're thinking of going through true education, don't just think about the time you get children. You yourself, you need to be taught. In fact, when they left Egypt, Israelites, the problem was not with the young people. The problem was not with the children. The problem was with who? It was with the older people. The younger people were easier to accept God's leading. But us guys who have been entrenched in Babylonian thinking, we need a lot of prayers and a lot of work that God has to do to change our thinking. So it is a long journey, and it will take time and a lot of sacrifice and a lot of prayer and study to understand God's ideal for us in true education. Just like he had to do for the Israelites. They would have been in Canaan in less than 3 weeks. They would have been there in a very short time. But because they had to be trained, they had to remain in the desert for a long time. Therefore sprang there even one, and him as good as dead, so many as the stars of the sky in multitude, as the sand which is by the seashore innumerable. As God dealt with the one man, so he dealt with the nation. As he had led the man from a lowly plane to an exalted position, so he led the nation until they stood a spectacle to the whole world. He chose them, not because of their great numbers, but taking the fewest of men, he wished to show to the world what would be done by the power of love. This is the Living Fountains and Broken Systems. Okay? These small people, however, were intended to lead the world and live in every sense of the word. They might lead instead of being led. He made them a peculiar people unto himself, giving them in the first place the rite of circumcision, which put a barrier forever between the believer in the God of Israel and all the nations of the world. This separation was for a purpose. God had a mission for the nation, and in order that it might be accomplished, every effort must be bent in that direction. Oneness of purpose is a divine law, and that Israel might lead, Israel must occupy a position in advance of all other people. For thou art an holy people, unto the Lord thy God. The Lord thy God hath chosen thee to be a special people unto himself, above all the people that are upon the face of the earth. The Lord did not set his love upon you, nor choose you, because you are more in number than any people, for you were the fewer of all the people. Okay, so he didn't choose them because they were big, but he chose them because he loved them. But because the Lord loved you, and because he would keep the oath which he fathers and to your fathers, and the Lord brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you out of the house of bondage from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. Know therefore that the Lord thy God, he is God, the faithful God, which keepeth covenant and mercy with them that love him and keep his commandments to a thousand generations. I'm just wondering whether you have ever thought, why is it that you have this truth? Why is it that God has chosen you with the present truth? Why is it that God has chosen you with the truth on health reform? That you can actually take that which the hospitals of the world have condemned, and using God's natural remedies, you can restore them to life. Why? Is it because you are special?
No.
I don't know if any of you are ordained elders here, or you are pastors, or you are gone to some theological school, or you are certain special privilege. I just see normal, ordinary people here. You know, so God didn't choose you because you were smart, or you were any better. But God loves you, and he wants to make a spectacle out of you to the whole world. He wants to show what he can do to those who can consecrate themselves to his service, and what he can be able to accomplish, especially in these last days. And so this is what God wanted to do with the Israelites. Okay? Now, the human being lives on three planes: the physical, mental, and spiritual. Okay? And you will find that the majority of people in the world today live on the physical planes, the five senses, you know, the sense of touch, the sense of taste, the sense of feel, the sense of hearing and sight. Right? And these senses are what most people respond to. Most people like sweet food. Most people like those things that are pleasing. You know, most people like appearances, right? And so you find people spend a lot of their money and time on the physical plane, right? And then the few live in the mental plane, okay? So men live in various planes, and those so constituted physically has to be content with the gratification of physical wants and desires. When you see this pyramid, so you see the majority are on the physical plane. They think the world is just physical, right? And then, this can readily be led by men who live on a mental plane, for mind has ever been recognized as superior to matter, okay? So that without knowing, the physically strong yields to his mental superior, isn't it? Is that not true?
Yeah.
Yes. You look at what happens in the disco. In the disco, you'll find a lot of young people have gone there to enjoy the music and all the madness that goes on in the disco. But the disco owner, him is laughing all the way to the what?
To
the back. He's not moved by the music or the drinks or the food that are going on. Him is counting the money and saying, these fools have brought me all this money. Alright? So the mental, naturally, will be superior to the physical. Alright? And so that is why you find the owner of the disco guy is nobody, very calm, very relaxed, just waiting as the money is coming in. Alright? And so, naturally, the mind will be superior to the body. Okay? Then we have from the physical, almost unconscious of his power, the man of the mental plane guides and controls those on the physical planes. Okay? But it was not as mere mental leaders that God called Israel. There is above the mental still the ladder which is scaled to a higher plane by very few. As the numbers decrease while passing from the physical to the mental plane, so they decrease yet more in passing from mental to the spiritual. Man reaches this highest plane of existence by what? By faith. It requires constant self-denial and continual development. In reality, it's living as seeing him who is invisible. Okay? The physical man depends almost entirely on knowledge gained through the senses. Right? The mentally developed depends upon reason. Many combine these two natures, and such individuals are guided by the sense of reason just in proportion as the two natures are developed. Knowledge as a result of sense perceptions and finite reason capture the majority of mankind. Finite reason and sense perceptions. That is what most of the human beings are classed with. The life of faith, the walking with God, takes in the few. And that is why God has chosen those few to be able to provide, to be at the light of the world, to go and provide and reach out to the rest of the masses that are simply depending on reason and sense perception. As individuals and as a nation, Israel was to stand upon the spiritual plane, attaining and maintaining the position by a life of faith. Standing there, it will be in accordance with the natural law, for all on the lower planes to yield obedience. As the mental controls the physical without any friction, so the spiritual controls all others. And so when we live by faith, when we trust God and His truth and His word, we will naturally be leaders, and people will be looking up to us. And I know sometimes in your homes people wonder about your peculiar habits, but quietly they are watching. They're saying, I think these people have something. They may not confess it, but they will know that these people, there is something that they have with you. The spiritual life differs from a purely physical or a strictly mental existence. And so when you look at the way education is conducted today, it's conducted purely from a mental and a physical sense. You have to go to the lab and examine this thing and do all kinds of investigations and then write a report. There is nothing spiritual about it. And that is why you can't mention the Bible in education. They want something they can reason out, because they live in the mental plane. That's the highest they can get. But for us who live in the spiritual plane, we know that these things were created by God. And that God has a law that we are supposed to live by. And even though the world does not admit it, most governments are governed by the spiritual law, the Ten Commandments. You will find that they pick a lot of, do not steal, do not kill, don't they use those laws? Do not commit adultery, honor your parents. They still end up using those laws. You know, I was reading somewhere that even the atheists confessed that Jesus Christ was born and is the Son of God. Because whichever paper that he writes, he must write the date from the time when Christ was born. Even when he's planning his lecture, he must plan it based on the date when Christ was born. I don't know if you guys are understood what I'm saying. Whether they are atheists, whether they are Buddhists, whether they are Muslims, the whole world lives by the date when Jesus Christ was born. Daily. Isn't it? We count from the time Christ was born. The world is led by the spirit. Right? However physical or mental they are led by the spirit. And it's when we fail to act our own part that we let down God. It made it impossible for any mingling of systems to take place without the utter reign of the spirit. For as soon as this came down to the level of either of the others, it ceased to be spiritual and lost its power. You cannot mingle the spiritual system with the mental. You cannot say, now, let us go and look for the philosophy of Egypt or Greek philosophy in order for us to acquire education. Our education must be based on a spiritual plane of existence. We know that we live as seeing Him who is what?
Invisible.
Who is what?
Invisible.
As long as Israel lived on the spiritual plane, they will be leaders of the nations. Remember Deuteronomy 4, verse 5 and 6, behold, I have taught you statutes and judgments
even as the Lord my God commanded me, that he should do so in the land with the ego possessed to possess it. Keep therefore and do them, for this is your wisdom and your understanding in the sight of the nations. Did you see that?
Yeah.
What is wisdom?
Jesus.
It is keeping the statutes that God has given us. The fear of God, that is wisdom. And to depart from evil is what?
Understand.
Now look, this is wisdom and understanding in the sight of the nations. When you fear God, the people out there will know that you have wisdom. Not you, it is those Gentiles who will know that you have what? Wisdom. Now, how can you then place down that wisdom and you go to those people and ask them for wisdom? How degrading can that be? The people who expect you to be light, you go to them for light. This is your wisdom and understanding in the sight of the nation, which shall hear all these statutes and say, surely, this great nation is a wise and understanding people. These are the words of God himself. He's shown you how you will get wisdom and understanding, and how people will know that you have wisdom and understanding. The Lord himself directed the education of Israel. His care was not restricted to their religious interests. Whatever affected their mental or physical well-being was also the subject of divine providence and came within the sphere of divine law. So education for Israel, and in true education, is not just reading your Bible and then going to a secular book to get your skills. No, everything that you do, God directed, and he has a plan on what we should be learning. God had commanded the Hebrews to teach their children his requirements and to make them acquainted with all his dealings with their father. This was one of the special duties of every teacher. One of the duties of every teacher. Every hired teacher. It was the duty of every what? Parent. One that was not to be delegated to another. In the place of stranger lips, the loving hearts of the father and mother were to give instruction to their children. This is Patriots and Prophets. This is a book that is in nearly every Adventist home, any serious Adventist. And yet they stand ignorant and say, what is true education? Why are you not taking your children to school? Then they go and report you to the police. And they say that these are their books, and we have them in their homes. When the word of God says there, the spirit of prophecy says that it is the loving hearts, the loving hearts of the father and mother are to give instruction to their children. Now, am I saying something strange? Can you see this? Because me, I'm just quoting. I'm not saying anything of it. This is in the books that you should be having. How many have got Patriarchs and Prophets? It's there, exactly. Page 592. So I want us to begin to take God at his word. Not stranger lips are the ones to give you knowledge and instruction. Thoughts of God were to be associated with all the events of the mighty works of God is the deliverance of his people, and the promises of the Redeemer to come were to be often recounted in the homes of Israel. And the use of figures and symbols caused the lesson to be given more firmly fixed in the memory. The great truths of God's providence and of the future life were impressed on the young man. It was strange to see God alike in the things of nature and the words of revelation. The use of figures and symbols in the training, in the teaching of maths and English, the thoughts of God are supposed to be impressed in the young man. So you hear what I said?
Yeah.
When you're teaching maths, You are supposed to be impressing God's thoughts in the young child. Now you tell me, how does the secular books impress the thoughts of God in their minds as they are acquiring their knowledge in minds? They say the monkey has two bananas and you like to share with, I don't know. Does that impress the thoughts of God in the young mind? So the teaching has to be different. It has to be a spiritual kind of education that instills and impresses in the mind of the child the thoughts of God. The stars of heaven, the trees and the flowers of the fields, the lofty mountains, the rippling brooks, all spoke of the Creator. The solemn service of sacrifice and worship at the sanctuary and the utterances of the prophets were a revelation of God. Sacred history and nature, these were the main textbooks. Such was the training of Moses in the lonely cabin in the Goshen, of Samuel by the faithful Hannah, of David in the hill dwelling of Bethlehem, of Daniel before the scenes of captivity separated him from the homes of his father. Such too was the early life of Christ at Nazareth. Such the training by which the child Timothy learned from the lips of his grandmother Lois and his mother Eunice the truths of Holy Scripture. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, See, I have called by name Bezaleel, the son of Uri, the son of Ur, of the tribe of Judah. And I have filled him with the Spirit of God in wisdom and in understanding, and in knowledge, and in all manner of workmanship. So God filled these people with wisdom to be able to construct the sanctuary, to devise cunning works, to work in gold and in silver and in brass, and in cutting of stones, to set them, and in carving of timber, to work in all manner of workmanship. You know, today we look at some of these stones they put on rings, and we think that these guys are so smart. Who gave this knowledge? It is God. It has been given, but it has been given for a holy purpose in the construction of the temple. That unusual knowledge of setting of stones, whether it be precious stones, but today the setting of precious stones is given to a diamond to put in rings and say, look, I have a diamond ring, I have a gold ring, or necklaces. All manner of selfish, idolatrous things. But God had given the knowledge and the skills for a holy purpose. And I, behold, have given with him Aholiab, the son of Ahisamach of the tribe of Dan. And in the hearts of all that are wise-hearted, I have put wisdom. God is the source of wisdom. And when we do true education, he shall give us the wisdom that that they may make all that I have commanded you. Alright. Let's look at a little bit more on what happened. Wherever in Israel God's plan of education was carried into effect, its result testified of its author. But in very many households, the training appointed by heaven and the characters thus developed were alike rare. Remember the first slides we saw? And because of their experience in Egypt, many parents were not willing to take up their responsibility as teachers of their children. God's plan was partially and imperfectly fulfilled. Mothers, fathers and mothers in Israel became indifferent to their obligation to God, indifferent to their obligation to their children. Through unfaithfulness in the home and idolatrous influences without, many of the Hebrew youth received an education differing widely from that which God had planned for them. They learned the ways of the heathen. I was speaking with somebody yesterday and I was quoting that verse. Let me look for that verse so that we can see that God has already spoken.
Thus saith the Lord, learn not the ways of the heathen, and be not dismayed at the sight of heaven, for the heathen are dismayed at them.
The word of God says, learn not the ways of what?
The
we still want to continue learning the ways of the heathen in the secular school, when God clearly says we should not learn the ways of the heathen. The Israelites did that. Let's see what happened. They became smart like you want to be today. Okay? They received an education differed widely from that which God had planned for them. They learned the ways of the heathen. Okay? These schools of the prophets, therefore, were intended to serve as a barrier against the widespreading corruption. As we learn the ways of the heathen, there is a widespreading corruption among us. To provide for the mental and spiritual welfare of the youth, and to promote the prosperity of the nation by furnishing it with men qualified to act in the fear of God as leaders and counselors. To this end, Samuel gathered companies of young men who were peers, intelligent, and studious. God doesn't force us. You want to go to the secular school? Go ahead. God will never force you. But in his mercy, he will try and set up schools of the prophets. People who will still come and reach out to you. People who will come and see you at home when you have got cancer. People will come and find you when you have been caught up with alcoholism because of the corruption that system of education has given. People who will come and reach out to you when you have separated from your wife or husband because of the pride of this life. There is no peace at home. When your children will not listen to you. People will come and pray for you. It is expensive to disobey God. There is no peace, says the Lord, for the wicked. There is no peace in disobedience. But he doesn't force us. God did not force you to go the true education. He allowed the Israelites to learn the ways of the heathen. But in his mercy, he set up schools of the prophets. There will be always a remnant who will listen to God's word and who will choose the path of true education. And those are the ones who will be beacons of hope to our disobedient and rebellious people. When Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, captured Jerusalem the first time, the king spake unto Ashpenaz, the master of the eunuchs, that he should bring seven of the children of Israel, of the king's seed and of the princes, children in whom was no blemish, but well favored, and skillful in all wisdom, and cunning in knowledge, and understanding science. Now, I want us to hold on there, because many times people use that example of Babylon and say, oh, you know, Daniel went to Babylon and he studied in the University of Babylon. And so when you look at that verse closely, we want to know what is it that was taught in the schools of the prophets. And you can see Nebuchadnezzar has just captured Jerusalem, and of all the people that he's taken as captives, he has told his commander of the guard to select from among the captives those who are skillful in wisdom and cunning in knowledge and understanding science. You cannot be selected to be skillful in wisdom if you did not have that wisdom. You cannot be understanding in science if you had not acquired that science from somewhere. And so it was clear that these skills and knowledge and understanding science was an ability that the captives already had. Otherwise, they would not have been chosen, is it?
Yeah.
And see why they were selected. Such as an ability in them to stand in the king's palace, whom they might teach the learning and the tongue of the Chaldeans. So they need to be wise people, they need to be cunning in knowledge and understanding in science, so that they can be equipped to run the affairs of the Chaldeans. Where then did Daniel and his three companions obtain the education which enabled them successfully to pass the examination required by King Nebuchadnezzar? Where did they obtain an education which made them skillful in all wisdom and cunning in knowledge and understanding science, and which gave them the ability in all these things? Without hesitation, it can be answered in the school of the prophet, the divinely established school in Israel. For in the 18th year of Josiah, king of Judah, which was only 15 years before the captivity of Daniel, there is a clear record of such a school in Jerusalem. Look at 2 Chronicles 34, verse 14 to 20. We can see there that in the 18th year of Josiah, while at his command, the temple was being cleansed and repaired from the abomination of Manasseh. A copy of the book of the law of Moses was found by Hilkiah the priest. Hilkiah delivered the book to Shaphan, the scribe, and Shaphan carried the book to the king and read before the king. And it came to pass, when the king had heard of the words of the law, he rent his clothes and commanded Hilkiah the priest and Shaphan the scribe and others, go inquire the Lord for me and for them that are left in Israel and in Judah, concerning the words of the book that is found. Inquire of the Lord for me, for them that are left in Israel. Okay? Let's see. Where did he go to inquire? And Hilkiah, and they that the king had appointed, went to Huldah the prophetess. Now she dwelt in Jerusalem in the college. There was a college in Jerusalem. And they spoke to her to that effect. Here was in Jerusalem a college or school in which dwelt the what? Prophetess. This at once shows this school to have been a school of the prophets, because that which gave to the schools the name schools of the prophet was the fact that a prophet dwelt with the school and was under God, the head of the school. Remember, Samuel is the one who set up the schools of the prophets, isn't he? And then later we read about Elisha. He was conducting the schools of the prophets when they were building up the schools, and they went to cut wood and the axe fell. That school, any school of the prophet, was so because a prophet was there. And so the prophet was the leader. So, the subject that we're taught was wisdom. Wisdom signifies knowledge, understanding, and intelligence. It implies the faculty to discern what is valuable knowledge and the ability and capacity to acquire that knowledge. So, wisdom is that ability to select that useful knowledge. From a mass of different kinds of knowledge, then you pick the knowledge that you think is useful. When you are given, let's say you are given 10,000 shillings, okay? There are three people. You are given 10,000 shillings, and you have been to a basic school, alright? And when you are given 10,000 shillings each, depending on what you do with that 10,000 shillings, you will display wisdom. One of you will go and buy an iPhone. Another one will go and buy a dress. Another one will go and buy a piece of land in the country. Who has wisdom? You see, so wisdom is being able to apply and select that knowledge that is useful. Okay? All of you are knowledgeable, and you are capable of doing any of the three choices. You have the ability and the capability to do them. But the person who selects the useful knowledge and makes use of it, that is the person that is deemed wise. So people who are foolish are not ignorant. I need you to understand that. Foolish people are not ignorant. Foolish people are people who have the knowledge that they need to make the right choice, but they make the wrong choice. That is why the Bible says that a fool sees danger and he walks right towards it. He's not somebody who is suddenly accosted by danger. No, no, no. He sees it there and he walks right on. But a wise man does what? He hides himself. We read that last year. You guys have forgotten. It's in the Bible. It's not my words. Okay. Knowledge relates to the mind or thought and implies knowledge acquired by thinking and application. Science signifies skill, dexterity, sagacity, ability to judge, and is well translated in our word science, which signifies skillful in knowledge. It implies a selected and systemized knowledge. Science is when you pick different pieces of knowledge and you combine them to achieve something specific.
Where is the Natalia? Here. You know, the other day I ate bread.
Now Natalia just took meat
and took some other ingredients
and he combined them in a skillful way, and I'm sure you enjoyed the bread, isn't it?
Yeah.
Now that is science. Many of us have access to wheat, but we can't bring that kind of bread. So science is that ability to take that which is available, commonly available, but you combine it in a skillful way to achieve a certain end. So these were the subjects that were taught. Yesterday we were being taught the science of natural chemotherapy.
Wait, my friend.
I came when it was almost ending, so I asked him to please give me a repeat of that science, right? Instead of the toxic substances that people are being given out there that make people lose their hair and lose their fertility and just lose their feeling and all that stuff, there is a better science. And these are the things that we should be teaching in the schools of the prophets. So we understand what is wisdom, all right? Wisdom is making the right choice of the knowledge that everybody has. Getting the right knowledge and being able to discern that which is valuable. I give you the example of the 10,000. There is the phone, there is the nice dress, and there is the piece of land. So wisdom is somebody being able to look at the three options and discern that which is valuable. Okay? And I can assure you guys, if you guys are given 1 million shillings each day, we shall see wisdom and foolishness. Because we need the grace of God to be able to discern that which is valuable so that we can use that money correctly. You spend that which is not what? You spend your money for that which is not bread. Jesus Christ told us. Many times we spend our money acquiring a useless education. And we come to realize when it is too late. Music is also taught in the schools of prophets, that thou shalt meet a company of prophets coming down from the high place with a psaltery and a tabret and a pipe and a harp before them, and they shall prophesy. Let me tell you today that music is what has killed adventism. The lack of a proper theology on music is what has killed our churches. And I can tell you, even amongst us, we are still very ignorant of what is true music. What is the correct music that God expects us to use in praise? And we don't understand the implication of listening to wrong music. It is something that should be taught vigorously, especially among the remnant. I went to my home the other day, and I found that the music madness has reached my home church. My church now sings with the keyboard. And they like to sing like that. You know that came from Vatican II? Did you guys know that?
Yes.
That is the result of Vatican II. It has penetrated the most remote church in this country. There is a signature, there is a keyboard, or they have gone to the studio and they have... In fact, they don't use a keyboard. They use the CDs. They just have a player. And so they go to church and they mime as the player is playing. The background. So you hear very high quality music, but the singers are just mining. You will know that when there's a blackout. Then they're stuck. Thou shalt not bear false witness. Every Sabbath choirs bear false witness, claiming, pretending they are praising God, but it is the player that is doing what? Music. We need to have a proper training on Because I am sure here, many of us are clueless about the correct music that we should be listening to. So God is the foundation of everything. All true science is in harmony with His works. All true education leads to obedience to His government. Science opens new wonders to our view. She soars high and explores new depths, but she brings nothing from her research that conflicts with divine revelation. Ignorance may seek to support false views of God by appeals to science, but the book of nature and the written word shed light upon each other. No finite mind can fully comprehend the existence, the power, the wisdom, or the works of the infinite one. Says the sacred writer, canst thou by searching find out God? Almighty unto perfection. It is as high as heaven. What canst thou do? Deeper than hell, what canst thou know? The measure thereof is longer than the earth and broader than the sea. The mightiest intellect of earth cannot comprehend God. Men may be ever searching, ever learning, and still there is an infinity beyond. Mind you what? We were here yesterday. Alright? Have we become friends with Manuwak? We are still struggling. Okay, let's see. And the sons of the prophet said unto Elisha, behold now, the place where we dwell in thee is too straight for us. Let us go, we pray thee, unto Jordan, and take thence every man, everyone went to the river. Okay? And let us make us a place there where we may dwell. Learn how to be in your own house. It is expensive to go there. Foolish. Hello? There's some things you have to learn how to do so that you can cut down your costs. The schools of the prophets, they taught themselves how to put up structures. Okay? And he answered, go and say what? Be content, I pray thee, and go with thy servant. And he answered, I will go. So he went with them. And when they came to the Jordan, they cut down wood. Okay? The peoples of this school sustained themselves by their own labor in tilling the soil or in some mechanical employment. In Israel, this was not thought strange or degrading. Indeed, it was regarded as a sin to allow children to grow up in ignorance of useful labor. Every youth, whether his parents were rich or poor, was taught some trade. Okay? Even though he was to be educated for holy office, a knowledge of practical life was regarded as essential to the greatest usefulness. Many also of the teachers supported themselves by manual labor. I saw my friend, he had bought a motorbike. Wait, Brian. Okay. You know one thing I came to learn when you go to the countryside, you have to learn to fix those things that you buy. You know, we have a generator and sometimes we have a problem. I have had to learn how to open that generator and fix it. Because we are too far from the cities. And there is nobody who will agree to come there. It will take days and you need to pump water. So you have to learn to open that generator and see what is the problem. When you go to the country, you have to learn all manner of things. You have to learn a trade. And when you are specialized in a trade, you might help your neighbor. Okay? So he was taught a trade. Even though he was to be educated for holy office, a knowledge of practical life was regarded as essential to the greatest usefulness. Alright? Many also of the teachers supported themselves in manual labor. These schools proved to be one of the means most effective in promoting the righteousness which exalted a nation. In no small degree, they aided in laying the foundation of that marvelous prosperity which distinguishes the reigns of David and Solomon. You never found that Israel going to look for agreement with the Philistines. No. They were their enemies. No Israelite went to Syria to seek it.